You gotta be 21 to hear that song. Oh, slip it in. Yeah. Right.
sometimes you need to, well, you know how, well, a boy's got a, and this girl's got this other thing, and, well, a few of you know how it goes together, but, it's one of those stories that always seems to come together in the end, you know. But the thing is, you know, sometimes it's like mining for gold. I mean, how do you get it? How do you get it? You can't do it by mental telepathy, can you? You have to ask for it, don't you? When you want something, how do you ask for it? How do you ask for it? You. Who wants something? Does anyone want it? When you want something, what do you? How do you ask for it?
That's right.
When you want something, how do you ask for it?
Fucking give it to me.
Well, what was the verb you said?
Give it to me.
Give me what?
Fucking give it to me.
Did you say give me or gimme?
Fucking give it to me.
You mean gimme? Give you what? Gimme something? Oh, you mean like gimme? Like gimme?
Gimme!
I need some more.
Gimme. Don't ask what for.
Standing here like a loaded gun, waiting to go off. I've got nothing to do but shoot my mouth off.
Gimme. Give me some more.
Gimme.
We'll be right back. Can we all dream of? Thank you. Wetness story is going to be called The Slow Little Turtle. When the 20 little mud turtles broke their eggshells one hot summer day and poked their way up through the warm sand in which the eggs had been buried, they looked almost as much alike as so many raindrops. The mother turtle, who was sunning herself on the bank nearby, said to her friends, "Why, there are my children. Did you ever see a finer family? I believe I will go over and speak to them." Most of the young mud turtles crawled quickly out of the sand and broken shells and began drying themselves in the sunshine. One slow little fellow stopped to look at the broken shells, stubbed one of his front toes on a large piece, and then sat down to wait for it to stop aching. "Wait for me," he called out to his brothers and sisters. "I'm coming in a minute." The other turtles waited, but when his toe was comfortable again and he started toward them, he met a very interesting snail and talked a while with him. "Come on," said the biggest little turtle, "let's not wait any longer. He can catch up." So they sprawled along until they came to a place where they could sit in a row on an old log. Climbed onto it and sat just close enough together and not at all too close. Then the slow little turtle came hurrying over the sand with a rather cross look in his eyes, putting his feet down a little harder than he needed to, as though he were out of patience about something. "Why didn't you turtles wait for me?" he grumbled. "I was coming right along." Just then, the mother turtle came up. "Good morning," said she. "I believe you are my children." She drew a long mud turtle breath and answered her own question. "Yes," she said, "you certainly are, for I saw you scrambling out of the sand a little while ago, and you came from the very place where I laid my eggs and covered them during the first really warm nights this year. I was telling your father only yesterday that it was about time for you to hatch. The sun had been so hot lately that I was sure you would do well." The mother turtle stretched her head this way and that until there was hardly a wrinkle left in her neck skin. She was so eager to see them all. "Why aren't you up there with your brothers and sisters?" she asked suddenly of the slow little turtle, who was trying to make a place for himself on the log. "They didn't wait for me," he said. "I was coming right along, but they wouldn't wait. I think they are just as mean." The mother turtle raised one of her forefeet until all five of its toes with their strong claws were pointing at it. She also raised her head as far up as her upper shell would let her. "So you are the one," she said. "I thought you were when I heard you trying to make the others wait. It is too bad." She looked so stern that the slow little turtle didn't dare finish what he had begun to say, yet down in his little turtle heart he thought, "Now they are going to catch it." He was sure his mother was going to scold the other turtle children for leaving him. He wanted to see what they would do, so he looked out of his right eye at the 10 brothers and sisters on that side, and out of his left eye at the 9 brothers and sisters on that side. He could do this very easily because his eyes are not on the front of his head, but one on each side. "I have raised families of young turtles every year," said the mother turtle. "The first year I had only a few children. The next year I had more, and so it has gone. Every year a few more children than the year before, until now I never know quite how many I do have. But but there's always one slow little turtle who lags behind and wants the others to wait for him. That makes him miss his share of good things, and then he is certain to think that it is somebody else's fault. Slow little turtle felt the 10 brothers and sisters on his right side looking at him out of their left eyes, and the 9 brothers and sisters on his left side looking at him out of their right eyes. He drew in his head and his tail and his legs until all they could see was his rounded upper shell, his shell side walls, and the yellow edge of his flat lower shell. He would have liked to draw them in too, but of course he couldn't do that. "I did hope," said the mother turtle, "that I might have one family without such a child in it. I cannot help loving even a slow child who is cross if he is hatched from one of my eggs. Yet it makes me sad, very, very sad." "Try to get over this," she said to the slow little turtle, "before it is too late. And you," she added, turning to his brothers and sisters, "must be patient with him. We shall not have him with us long." "What do you mean?" asked the slow little turtle, peeping out from between his shells. "I'm not going away." "You do not want to," said his mother, "but you will not be with us long unless you learn to keep up with the rest. Something always happens to pond people who are too slow. I cannot tell you what it will be, yet it is sure to be something. I remember so well my first slow child and how he..." She began to cry, and since she could not easily get her 4 feet to her eyes, she sprawled to the pond and swam off, with only her head and a little of her upper shell slowly showing above the water. The slow little turtle was really frightened by what his mother had said, and for a few days he tried to keep up with the others. Nothing happened to him, and so he grew careless and made people wait for him, just because he was not quite ready to go with them, or because he wanted to do this or look at that or talk to some other person. He was a very trying little turtle, yet his mother loved him and did not like it when the rest called him a land tortoise. "It is all right, you know, to be a land tortoise when your father and mother are land tortoises. And these cousins of the turtles look so much like them that some people cannot tell them apart. They forget that tortoises live on land, have higher back shells, and move slowly. Turtles live more in the water and can move quickly if they will. This is why other turtles sometimes make fun of a slow brother by calling him a land tortoise." One beautiful sunshiny afternoon, when most of the 20 little turtles were sitting on a floating log by the edge of the pond, their mother was with some of her friends on another log nearby. She looked often at her children and thought how handsome their rounded up back shells were in the sunshine, with the little red and yellow markings showing on the black. She could see their strong little pointed tails, too, and their webbed feet with a stout claw on each toe. She was so proud that she could not help talking about them. "Is there a sight any more beautiful," she said, "than a row of good little turtles?" "Yes," said a fine old fellow who was floating near her, "a row of their mothers." He was a turtle whom she had never liked very well. Now she began to think that he was rather agreeable after all. She was just noticing how beautifully the skin wrinkled on his neck when she heard a splash and saw two great two-legged animals wading into the pond from the shore. "Boys," she cried, "boys!" And she sprawled off the end of her log and slid into the water, all of her friends following her. The biggest little turtle saw these great animals coming toward him. He sprawled off the end of his log and slid into the water, and all his brothers and sisters followed him except the slow little turtle. "Wait for me," he said. "I'm coming in just a..." Then one of these great animals stooped over and picked him up and held him bottom side uppermost and wrapped on that side, which was flat, and on the other side, which was rounded, and stared at him with two great eyes. Next, the other great animal took him and turned him over and wrapped down his shells and stared at him. The poor slow little turtle drew in his head and tail and legs and kept very, very still. He wished that he had side pieces of shell all around now instead of just one on each side between his legs. He was thinking over and over, something has happened, something has happened. And he knew that back in the pond, his mother would be trying to find him and could not. The boys carried him to the edge of the meadow and put him down on the grass. He lay perfectly still for a long, long time, and when he thought they had forgotten about him, he tried to run away. Then they laughed and picked him up again. It was not until the sun went down that the boys let the slow little turtle go. Then he was very tired, but he wanted so much to get back to his home in the pond that he started at once by moonlight. He was not quite sure which way he should go, and if it had not been for the kindness of the tree frog, he might never have seen his little brothers and sisters again. The tree frog hopped along ahead to show the way, and the turtle followed until they could reach a place from which they could see the pond. "Good night," said the tree frog. "You can find your way now." "Good night," said the turtle. "I wish I might help you sometime." "Never mind me," said the tree frog. "Help somebody else and it will be all right." He hopped back towards his home, and for a long time afterwards, the turtle heard his cheerful purp, purp, purp sounding over the dewy grass and through the still air. At the edge of the pond, the slow little turtle found his 19 brothers and sisters sound asleep. "I'm here," he cried joyfully, poking first one and then another with his head. The biggest little turtle moved without awakening. "I tell you, I'm not hungry," he murmured. "I don't want to get up." And again he fell fast asleep. So the slow little turtle did not disturb them, but cuddled inside his two shells and went to sleep also. He was so tired that he did not awaken until the sun was high in the sky. When he did open his eyes, his relatives were sitting around looking at him, and he remembered all that had happened before he slept. His mother came and leaned to her shell lovingly against his. "If you will only learn to keep up with your brothers and sisters," she said, "I shall not be sorry that the boys carried you off." "You just wait and see," said the slow little turtle, and he was as good as his word. After that, he was always the first to slip from the log to the water if anything scared them. And when, one day, a strange turtle from another pond came to visit, he said to the turtles who had always lived there, "Why do you call that young fellow the slow little turtle? He is the quickest one in his family." The pond people looked at each other and laughed. "After this, we will call him the quick little turtle," they said. The end of the story. One is going to be called The Three Little Pigs. Once upon a time, there were three little pigs. One day, their mother said, "You are old enough to look out for yourselves now. It is time for you to go out into the world and build homes of your own." The three little pigs were very excited. They walked together as far as the crossroads, and there they parted. "Goodbye," they called to one another as they set off in different directions. The first little pig always did things in a hurry. He built himself a house of straw in the first sunny field he came to. It was light and airy and smelt of harvest time, and it swayed gently whenever the wind blew. One day he saw a wicked old wolf walking across the field. "Oh!" cried the first little pig and ran inside his house of straw. The wolf knocked at the door and called, "Open the door, little pig, and let me come in." He wanted the little pig for his dinner. The first little pig shivered and shook. "By the hair on my chinny chin chin, I will not open the door and let you come in. Then I will huff, and I will puff, and I will blow your house down," growled the wolf. And he huffed and he puffed until that house of straw blew away. That was the end of the first little pig. The second little pig never quite finished anything he started. He built himself a house of sticks in a shady wood. It was full of gaps and creaked whenever the wind blew. One day he saw a wicked old wolf walking along the woodland path. "Oh!"
cried the second little pig and ran inside his house of sticks. The wolf knocked at the door and called, "Open the door, little pig, and let me come in." He wanted this little pig for his dinner. The second little pig shivered and shook. "By the hair on my chinny chin chin, I will not open the door and let you come in. Then I will huff, and I will puff, and I will blow your house down," growled the wolf. And he huffed, and he puffed, until the house of sticks tumbled down. And that was the end of the second one. The third little pig always did things properly, even if it took him a long time. He built a house of bricks at the bottom of a steep hill. It was snug and warm and stood firm and strong. One day he saw a wicked old wolf walking down the hill. "Oh," cried the third little pig and ran inside his house of bricks. The wolf knocked at the door and called, "Open the door, little pig, and let me come in." He wanted the little pig for his dinner. The third little pig shivered and said, "By the hair on my chinny chin chin, I will not open the door and let you come in. And I will huff, and I will puff, and I will blow your house down," growled the wolf. And he huffed, and he puffed, and then he huffed, and he puffed again. The wicked old wolf huffed and he puffed until he was quite out of breath, but the house of bricks stood as firm and as strong as a mountain. He could not blow it down. If he wanted to catch the little pig, he would have to entice him out of the house. "Little pig," he called, "meet me at the orchard at 10 o'clock tomorrow morning, and I will show you where the best apples are." The third little pig knew how crafty and full of tricks the old wolf was, so the next morning he got up very early. He went to the orchard and picked all the best apples and was safely home again by 10 o'clock. When the wicked old wolf got to the orchard and found the best apples gone, he knew the third little pig had tricked him. He was very angry, but he tried not to show it. He went back to the house of bricks and knocked at the door. "Are you going to the market tomorrow?" he called in his most sly voice. "Yes, I am," said the little pig. "I will meet you at 8 o'clock and we can walk there together," said the wolf. "Don't be late." The third little pig got up very early indeed the next morning. "I will be home from the market before the old wolf is even awake," he said. But he was wrong, because the wolf got up early too. The little pig was very frightened when he saw the wolf coming up the hill, and he hid inside an empty milk churn which was standing beside the road. The milk churn began to roll. It rolled down the hill, faster and faster and faster. It bumped right into the old wolf and sent him sprawling. "Oh," cried the wolf. He could not believe his eyes when he saw the little pig hop from the milk churn and run into the house of bricks and slam the door. He was very angry indeed. If he could not catch the little pig outside the house, then he would have to get into the house. If the little pig would not let him in through the door, then he would go down the chimney. The third little pig heard the wolf scrambling about on the roof. "That wicked wolf will never catch me," he cried. He put a pot full of water on the fire and waited. Rumbling and grumbling in the chimney got louder, and then suddenly there was a great big splash. The wicked old wolf fallen straight into the pot, and that was the end of him. And the third little pig lived happily ever after. The third story is going to be
Mm-hmm.